Okay, whenever you're ready.
You can just tell the story.
Yeah.
Fire and what happened.
Well, I was here to start with the science. This is the beginning on March 21st. We were all victims of a fire. The fire was lit by somebody. It was arson, and they never found out who did it. And since then, we have been put in hotels, bumped around, different places. It started out as me in a tent, actually. Didn't know where I was going to go until Red Cross said that they could help us out and get us in a hotel for 2 weeks. We took the Red Cross's help, went into a hotel for 2 weeks, and that ended then, and we were pretty heartstruck because we thought we were going to stay for a while, you know, months or something, until we could find new homes. But we haven't even had a chance to really find new homes because it's so hard. So the Salvation Army put us up for a while in their church, domestic in their church, about 30 or 40 of us, for 6 weeks almost, for almost a month, until they couldn't do it anymore because there wasn't allowed to be women in the facility, and we had women there, so we had to leave. And then they found us a facility in downtown at 911 Hemrick Street, the Youth Detention Custody Center, and we've been there now for almost over a month, and we just found out that we're going to have to leave there again on June 6th. And we have absolutely no word of where we're going to go. There's absolutely no affordable housing anywhere in Victoria. I have excessively searched the market in so many different ways, so many different angles. I've tried everything, you know, even almost lying to make myself sound better. And this just hasn't gotten anywhere.
Here to talk about the current state of homelessness here in this community as well as across North America, and it exists, of course, elsewhere in the world, too. It's a very complex subject to tackle, but tonight we have the pleasure of hosting three mayors who have each worked on their own unique solutions and some ideas that they've already shared with each other throughout the day today, which they will share with all of us and all of you here tonight. So it is our place, First Metropolitan, the City of Victoria, that have come together to make this happen. Let me introduce to you the folks that are on this panel that you'll hear from shortly. First of all, Mayor Kitty Piercy from the City of Eugene, Oregon. Seated next to her is Mayor Ted Clugston of Medicine Hat, Alberta. We have some Alberta people here, don't we? And of course, we all know Mayor Lisa Helps of the City of Victoria. So what's going to happen is that the mayors will make some opening comments. They may have some dialogue among themselves, too. There's a series of questions that have been put in place, which I'm going to pose to start some discussion among the mayors, too. After that, we're going to be welcoming questions from you. The format tonight that we're offering is that if you have questions you would like to pose to any of the mayors, we're going to ask that you write them down. There are volunteers here that will accept those from you. There are the volunteers holding up the clipboards right now where that's going to happen. If you need any assistance with the writing or the phrasing of your question, we're not going to have any questions from the floor verbally tonight. We ask that you respect that. We're here mostly for a dialogue and to listen and be a part of the conversation that the mayors are having. So we're here respectfully and peacefully to do this here tonight. So we appreciate very much your consideration of doing that, and we hope that that will be the spirit of what we're doing here tonight. So when you want a question, if you want to write it down, just put your hand up. They will come to you and they'll give you a piece of paper, and then those will be brought to me, which we will integrate into the program as we continue on. Last order of business, this is very important. The washrooms are this way. They are to my left, to your right. Make your way down there into the hallway. So to begin things tonight, we're going to first of all hear from someone who has, I think, come from the furthest away. It certainly involved crossing a border that wasn't a provincial border. Mayor Kitty Piercy from Eugene, Oregon, at one time served in the state legislature in her state. She served as a Democrat. In her career, she has been a teacher. She one time in her life served overseas with the Peace Corps in the United States, too. She has a long record of community service, and we're very pleased to welcome Mayor Kitty Piercy of Eugene, Oregon.
Thank you.
So it's very much my pleasure to be here. You've made me very welcome. I want to thank our place. They've done a wonderful job. They had us do 2 radio shows and 4 site visits today. We've had a busy day and enjoyed it very much and feel very welcome here. You have a beautiful place to live. I'm going to quickly try to go through some information to sort of lay some groundwork and things to think about, and then we'll be back for questions later. Oh, and I should say today in the United States, it's Memorial Day, so it's a big day to remember people who have sacrificed for our nation, and among those are a homeless population, a huge portion are veterans, so just to remember that today as well. So I hope I can figure out how to make this work. I'm going to talk about the efforts to address housing and homelessness in our communities. We're going to talk about facts from Eugene. We're going to talk about community and regional approach, not just the city. And we're going to review some key projects and programs in our organization and community. So let's see how this goes. Look at that, it worked. Nope, I went too far, didn't I? Yeah, okay. So we do a homeless point in time count. We just finished it, came out just a couple weeks ago. You will see that we still have a lot of unhoused people in Eugene, Oregon. Last count, 1,451 homeless folks. Over 12,000 who were identified as homeless sought services in the last 12 months. And we have managed to house, seems like a lot, but it's not enough. We housed 644 people last year. Issue has become more visible to the community in recent years, and we often talk about its impact on public safety, its impact on emergency services, all of those kinds of things, but it also has an impact on the livability of our community. It also has an impact on our parks and open space. And of course, most importantly, it has a huge impact on the lives of those who are unhoused. So the other thing you should know about our community is we have a private shelter that shelters about 300 people a night, but we have no public shelter, working on that issue. And we have limited funding available for temporary solutions, so we are not a community that is flush with resources. We take a regional approach to homelessness. We have something called the Lane County Poverty and Homeless Board, where we bring everyone together. That would be the county, the city next to us, the faith community, the business community, the homeless community, housing and service providers, the VA, schools, workforce, investment, and law enforcement, and all work on these issues together, because we can do a lot more when we bring all our resources together. And the city contributes funding to our human services program, along with the county and our adjoining city. Last year, we committed over $1.2 million in funds to the Human Services Commission to support critical services for people in poverty. Like my colleague next to me, we have adopted a housing first model. We haven't gotten as far as they have, but we have unanimously adopted it. Access to permanent supported housing, no preconditions or barriers to entry such as sobriety or a clean criminal history. Supportive services are available to maximize housing stability. It's not a substitute for current or future programs related to emergency needs. You need all of it. So here are some things that are innovative that we've been doing that you may want to, I think some of them you know about and some of them you may not. We have Rest Stop Program, Opportunity Village, and Emerald Village. Rest Stops and Opportunity Village are communal living arrangements with self-governing communities that empower residents to take responsibility for the functioning of their community. So we'll go through this in the next few pages. The model creates strong bonds among residents and provides a purpose and a sense of empowerment that people who are homeless on the streets do not have. So here is our rest stop program, established in 2013. Provides temporary shelter for 15 to 20 people per site. Sites cannot be located near residential areas or schools. A rest stop requires council approval and site agreement with the third-party operator. It sunsets regularly. We've extended it 4 times. The original intent of this program was to try something new that would allow temporary, safe, and legal transitional shelter for the unhoused. The base of the program requires a partnership between the city and private entities willing to manage the rest stops. This format has given the community a way to contribute through a partnership with us at no cost to the city. We provide the land, the community makes all the shelters, provides the porta potties, provides the waste pickup, takes care of the place. It's all a communal effort. It was initiated in 2013 by ordinance. We have 3 sites on city property, 2 on county property, and 1 at the Eugene Mission. We have 1 more catering to women to open in the next month. Each site caters to a different demographic group. 1 of the sites caters to veterans, another to women, another to young adults, and another with people with mental and physical disabilities. While considered a stopgap or band-aid, as we've talked about many times today, emergency sheltering situation, rest stops do provide an opportunity for people in crisis to stabilize, access services needed, and focus on accessing employment and more permanent housing solutions. And I think it's really, I think maybe I'll see if this covers this, so hold on for a sec. Residents can leave their belongings there through the day. Through community and relation building, rest stops provide the needed emotional and physical support that homeless people need in order to take the next step. Residents are expected to contribute to the upkeep and governance of the camp, and they do, which instills pride and a sense of purpose, ownership, investment, and stability. And because they are staying in one place, it makes it easier for them to connect with social service providers and vice versa on a dependable basis. Benefits to the broader community have been reducing conflicts and impacts of illegal camping, as well as public expense of cleanup and calls for service, as I said earlier, with police and fire and so forth. The rest stops deter illegal camping where they are located, contributing to safer environments for the residents and for the neighbors. Residents also participate in public service projects. In fact, they help clean up our parks in town. In 2015, our rest stops served a total of 214 people. Nearly 75, nearly 75% of those entering rest stops in 2015 reported being from our area, not from out of town. I think people always ask that question. Turnover is frequent, with 80% of those served in 2015 having stayed for 6 months or less. The majority left voluntarily. 42 were asked to leave for rule violations. 44 who departed rest stops in 2015 moved into permanent housing. This includes a rental house or apartment, Section 8 housing, nonprofit housing, permanent living with family or friends, and permanent supported housing. 15 more moved into transitional housing, and 5 entered into assisted living facilities, and 4 entered into inpatient alcohol and drug treatment programs. One of our rest stop operators, Community Supported Shelters, has recently adopted a 10-month stay rule, with monthly check-in meetings with program directors to make sure residents are actively working toward making improvements in their lives. So here we are at Opportunity Village, which are a transitional micro-housing project created by Square One Village, local nonprofit, with connections to the local faith-based organizations. Residents pay a portion of their operational costs. They pay $30 a month. It's self-governed and peer-supported community. It's currently located on a small piece of city property. Born out of the tent cities of the Occupy movement, Opportunity Village opened in 2013. Like with the rest stops, residents are expected to adhere to rules around behavior and to contribute to the operations and maintenance of the village. Since the start of the project, there have been approximately 2 successful transfers out of the village for every resident that has been asked to leave. Turnover is less frequent at Opportunity Village than at rest stops, with 71% of those served have lived there greater than 7 months, including 11 people who've been there for 2 years. 13 of the 19 folks who departed the village in 2015 did so voluntarily, with 11 of them going on to permanent housing. So we're working on it all the time. Here's a new cool thing happening. This one, the next one up, it isn't on the ground yet, but it's coming this year. This is called Emerald Village Eugene. It's the next project for Square One Villages and Eugene's first permanent built micro housing project. It's considered multifamily development by the city code. The project has recruited 12 architects to design and build the houses and raised over $600,000 in gifts and pledges. The focus is on people who have transitioned out of homelessness and or who are at risk of becoming homeless. So more accessible and sustainable than Opportunity Village, each of the 22 houses are designed to meet the building code definition of a permanent dwelling, including sleeping and living area, kitchenette and bathroom. Common facilities include a community gathering area, kitchen, laundry, restroom, tool storage, and office. Unlike most affordable housing projects, residents of Emerald Village will not simply be renters, but instead will be members of a housing cooperative with a share in the ownership of the village, enabling them to create a modest asset that can be cashed out if and when they choose to leave. The building equity. Square One Villages will hold the property in trust to assure continued affordability to members of the cooperative into the future. Members will make monthly payments of $200 to $300 a month. Each household will accumulate a $1,500 share paid in increments on which they will earn simple interest. Affordable housing, the city of Eugene's affordable housing projects. We have 90 acres of land acquired, 23 projects containing 901 units since 1983, 48 units under development. Creating new affordable housing involves creating a pipeline for the development of housing affordable to people with incomes below 50% of AMI. It achieves dispersal. This is an important thing. We have a policy that you can't have all the affordable housing in one part of the community. It has to be dispersed throughout the entire community, and that's been very successful. Access to transit and services. The land is offered with home funds and systems development charge waivers and tax exemptions and leverages significant state, federal, and private resources. Housing rehab programs at the City of Eugene are another really important thing. I think we think about the need to build new housing, but in fact, we have to keep what we have. So rehabbing is really important to keep those houses in play, extending the life of the units, and then emergency, we do emergency home repair programs, support low-income residents so that they can stay in their housing as well. And finally, a couple of recent initiatives we've done. We're working on something called 15th Night, which is to get young people into housing before they've been out on the streets more than 14 days, because we know from statistically, if they're out longer than that, they're probably not going to get back home again. So this is an effort to get them home again. And then in terms of housing first model, last year we did join the Mayor's Challenge in Veterans Homelessness, bringing partners together, and we set a goal to house 365 vets last year, unhoused vets, and we housed 404. So we did okay. Finally, this is one of the, when we're trying to do things in different ways and really leverage what we have, this is a picture of the mayors of San Francisco, Los Angeles, Portland, and Seattle, and a little old mayor from Eugene talking about how we can all work together to end homelessness on the West Coast of the United States. Thank you.
Mayor Kitty Pierce of Eugene, Oregon, thank you very much for that. For some perspective, I just wanted to mention the population of Eugene, Oregon, I believe, Mayor, is about 160,000. Is that right? So in comparison to the other two communities we're going to hear from tonight, so 160,000 people is the critical mass of population in Eugene, Oregon. So much to think about there. If you have some questions for the mayor, please let one of the volunteers know. They will pass you a piece of paper and you can write the question down. The next mayor is from a municipality of about 65,000 in Medicine Hat, Alberta, which has the unique challenge of one of the places that is home to a true Canadian winter. That's one of the things that's a factor in what happens. This gentleman was served on council before he was the mayor. Longtime community volunteer, has served on every single committee that exists in his community, of which he is now the mayor. Would you please welcome the mayor of Medicine Hat, Alberta, Ted Clugston.
I like to stand. Very, very good presentation. So I'm going to take a slightly different approach. I am going to tell you a story, frankly. I think everybody's fairly aware of the success in Medicine Hat and what's happened in Medicine Hat, and it's been widely publicized, and you can read about it, you know, and I have a YouTube video of one of many that, you know, has 14 million views. So people have been talking about this Medicine Hat. So I'm not the specialist and the passion that Mayor Percy and Mayor Helps have. I'm a little different, and so I'm going to tell you the story of how I came to actually be standing here today, and it's a little different, and maybe it's a story of hope, and maybe a story of, raised awareness, perhaps. But it really is an honor for me to be here today, and Victoria, you have been a great host today. Thank you very much, and a very gracious host, and I love coming out here, and I really enjoyed my tour, and it was a bit of an eye-opener. And so I kind of had a speech, and now you can see that I basically, right before I got here, basically destroyed it and changed it because of what I've seen here today. So I'm in a little bit of a way I'm winging it. So I'm going to tell you, because I am held out across this country as the mayor that ended homelessness. I'm not the mayor that ended homelessness. I'm the mayor that happened to be the mayor of a city at the time that they ended homelessness. Okay, so there is a very big difference. I'm watching I've been talking all day with Mayor Percy, and she is very hands-on and very passionate. And frankly, I'm very hands-off, to tell you the truth. So, and I know, and I see this, people, if we held this in Medicine Hat right now, there wouldn't be anybody here. So you caught me a little off guard. Oh, I think I even have... my presentation is just pictures of Medicine Hat. So, I'm not as well prepared. But that's a picture of our city hall and the beautiful South Saskatchewan River. In 2013, that river was touching our city hall. So we've had our challenges in Medicine Hat. This isn't working, but I'll leave that there. And I know that you're coming here tonight and this room is packed and you're looking to me for a magic bullet. Come here, Mayor Clugston, the mayor that ended homelessness, and end homelessness in Victoria. Tell us how to do it. And I'm going to be very blunt with you that I do not have the magic bullet, and I do not know Victoria. I don't know Vancouver. I don't know Toronto. I know Medicine Hat. That's it. And I want to make sure that everybody, and I said this on the radio this morning, that Mayor Helps knows that I'm not here to tell her she or you or anybody is doing it wrong, because I would frankly not be very happy if you came to my community and told me I was doing something wrong. So I'm here to just tell you a story about how I came to be who I am here. So I come from a background. I am the first male born in my family not to have a PhD in three generations. I just met a family member here who gave me my genealogy that I didn't even know. Thank you very much. didn't even know you existed. And so in my family, I was raised, you have to have a strong work ethic. You work hard, and if you work hard, anything is possible. And in my family, there is no or little or absolutely no tolerance to ask for a handout. And if you want success, any of you want success, you pull yourselves up by the bootstraps, you get a job, you get an education, and failure is not an option. So when I was first running for mayor, I never campaigned. I never even said the word homelessness never left my lips as I was campaigning. I was talking about our energy industry and its renewable energy and investment attraction. And early in my political career, I used to actually voice my opinion and actively, don't stone me when I'm telling you a story, I actively campaigned and made flippant gestures against affordable housing and made comments to the media I don't have granite countertops. Why should they? I have to work two jobs to keep a roof over my head. Why don't they? And so this was actually a fairly narrow view and not very helpful at all. And I actually even referred, and don't ever do this with the media, I actually referred to myself on national media as a bit of a cowboy in my old days. Never give the media a moniker so that they can call you, because CBC called me a cowboy for about a year. So as it turned out, many in the housing community over about 6 years, have patiently attempted to educate me and persuade me and show me statistics and the financial sense behind ending homelessness. And I remember when they first approached me and said that they had this idea and it was called Housing First and that the city of Medicine was going to end homelessness in 5 years, I was skeptical and I thought they were frankly a bunch of dreamers and bleeding hearts, socialists. And so they slowly and patiently attempted to educate me, and my community educated me, the people, this young lady here, educated, the people on the front lines talked to me and talked to me as a politician. And eventually swayed me and made me see the financial sense. And so I was standing on a stage, not unlike this in the city of Medicine Hat, talking about the same amount of people, not about homelessness, but I was called a State of the City speech, and there were about 400 people, and I was talking about all the things I love to talk about, capital projects and event centers and leisure centers and renewable energy. And I was flipping slides, which I unfortunately, oh, there we go, like this, and there was our flood. And I unfortunately had forgotten that I had left a slide in my presentation that said, oh yeah, and by the way, we might be the first city in Canada to end homelessness. And I flipped and kept on and didn't even mention that after that again. And what I didn't realize is that I had talked for an hour to the citizens of Medicine Hat about all the successes of Medicine Hat and what we were doing and what my dreams and visions were for Medicine Hat. And all the media came up to me and said, what about that homelessness thing? Tell us more about the homelessness thing. And then it ended up going national across this country that Medicine Hat might do this. And I had mayors calling me from across the country. And it was then, and from coast to coast, and then I realized, and woke up, that there was this aching desire. You're here tonight. There was this yearning to once and all do something about this chronic problem. And I think, like me, the rest of the country was growing up. And it is no longer acceptable to ignore this chronic problem, and that Medicine Hat, despite my efforts, had become a beacon of hope. And so I became the face of homelessness, or ending homelessness in this country, and I picked up that torch and I held it high because I needed this country, I realized this country needed a politician to take a leadership role on this issue. But really, I was standing on the shoulders of giants and the real heroes who do this work every day and for whom it is a passion. And I met many of them today again, and it reaffirmed my belief in Housing First. And so for me, for my old me, it is easy for me to ignore homelessness when it's in Toronto or Vancouver, but if I have to step over someone on my way to work, and damn it if we're not going to do something about it. And so homelessness will be solved in cities. It is cities. It's your own backyard. It's looking after your neighbor. Forget the province and forget the feds. Somebody in Ottawa does not know how to do it here in, this is my opinion, in Victoria, Vancouver, Toronto, Medicine Hat. But what we do need is the other levels of government to get on board, because municipalities only have 8% of the tax dollars. The rest of the levels of government have all the money. And we need a national housing strategy, and then we don't need talk. And I've made it very clear in my province that I despise our Prime Minister. However, I do believe that perhaps he may be the one that perhaps brings something like this forward. And hopefully they fund it, because talk is cheap. And I'm just going to finish with one more story. And it was a Sunday morning, and as the mayors know, we go to fundraisers, we go to ribbon cuttings. We're never in the office, not really doing anything. We're kissing babies all the day. I was kicking off the cancer relay. And thousands of people showed up in my city to walk or run and raise money for cancer. And then right after that, I had to rush off and I had to go to a diabetes fundraiser. It was also a walk, and hundreds of people showed up for the diabetes walk. And then I was finishing my day, and I had to show up and cut the ribbon at a schizophrenia walk. And it was supposed to start around noon. No one showed up, except for the executive director of the Schizophrenia Society in Medicine Hat. And she says to me, this is the third year in a row this has happened. And so I like to talk about mental illness and the stigma of medicine. So, and I said this on the radio today, when you get cancer, you don't want cancer. It's an illness. It happens. You don't want diabetes. You don't want kidney disease. It happens. But when you get these accepted diseases, your family stands behind you. Your friends stand behind you. I joke, people, lasagnas. I just had this happen to me in my house. Lasagnas show up at your front step and you eat and you have support and everybody helps you out and people raise money for you. But when you have a mental illness, no one shows up. Even your own family oftentimes turns their back on you and nobody fundraises for you. And so I like to make analogies. I come from a medical background, is that, you know, a lung cancer, you know, a symptom of lung cancer is a persistent cough. But a symptom of mental illness is homelessness. And you don't treat a lung cancer victim with cough syrup, and you don't treat homelessness with emergency shelters or hope. And you don't hope to cure it. So I'm going to give you just a little bit of what I know, what I've gleaned, what I've become, I've learned about ending homelessness. I'm going to give you, I know you're looking to me for how to do it, but I do believe medicine has successes. We're because we are a smaller city, but we were a wealthy city. We had the resources, but we were still small enough that everybody knew each other. And we were able to have, so we took a systems approach. And we have one point of entry, and it's the Medicine Hat Community Housing Association. And so when you do housing first, it's really good to know, so people don't fall through the cracks. And we're small enough to do that. And then get them the help they need. Is it mental health? Is it food? Is it food insecurity? Is it abusive relationship? Is it disabilities? And wrap those services around them. And so that's where we've been successful. And so I've been talking to the other communities about that, that you need to have one point of access. And everybody means well. The churches mean well, giving out food, and the food banks, you know, and individuals mean well, but when everybody does it without any coordination, you can't solve the problem. You need to have a coordinated approach. And so it's not against the churches. Like, so in Medicine Hat, we actively encourage our churches not to give out food. They want to give out food, but we tell them, give the food to the food bank, the central core, so we can find that person and keep track of them. Yes, raise money. Yes, get food, but make sure that we can get them to the food bank. And why are you at the food bank? Well, because I'm homeless. Okay, well, then we'll connect you with the resources. So I'm just trying to say what little I've known, and I hopefully maybe answer some questions later about what I've learned. But my goal is here is if there's anybody in this room who doesn't believe that you can end homelessness like I did believe that or didn't believe that you can. You really can. And so if someone like me can be converted, anybody can. Thank you.
They didn't call you a cowboy on CFAX today, did they? No.
I didn't think so.
No, not at all. So again, some food for thought there. Please write down any questions you might have to direct to Mayor Ted, which the volunteers will hand out to you in the sheets of paper that are there for you to take advantage of. So, Eugene, Oregon, 160,000 people. Medicine Hat, Alberta, 65,000 people. City of Victoria is about 78,000 people in a larger municipality, close to 400,000. As you know, the mayor of Victoria is Lisa Helps, who actually grew up in London, Ontario, listening to me play rock and roll music on the radio. She, of course, came here, sat on council. She was very active in her own neighborhood of Fernwood for a long time before she was on council and elected mayor. She was the executive director of a community micro-lending organization, a longtime proponent of sustainability, and shows no sign of fear in the face of any issue that she has faced as of yet. Would you please welcome the mayor of Victoria, Lisa Helps.
Thank you very much. Bruce has tasked me with the task of acknowledging all the elected officials and chiefs in the room. And since there are many, I'm going to ask all of the elected officials and chiefs here, I know almost all of Victoria City Council is here and a number of mayors, if you could stand up and be recognized and please give a round of applause to these folks who work very hard on your behalf every day. Chiefs and elected officials. Thank you very much. Well, I don't have a PowerPoint presentation because we live here and we know what it looks like. And I'm also not going to speak for very long. I do have some things to say, a little bit reflection on what the other mayors have said, but I'd really like to use this time this evening for you as a community learning experience so that we can learn more about what these folks know and take some of the lessons to heart and implement them here in Victoria. So I want to begin by acknowledging that we do have a problem in Victoria, as there is a problem in Eugene and a problem in all of the cities down the West Coast. No problem in Medicine Hat, and I think that is kudos to Mayor Clugston and the social service providers in Medicine Hat. So clearly we have some challenges here in Victoria, and the most notable one, obviously, are the people living in Tent City who are unfortunate enough to live in a tent in Canada in the 21st century. So I think that that is a blight on our nation. And there are five other tent cities in British Columbia right now, and that is a blight on our province. The people aren't a blight, don't get me wrong. The people are trying to live their lives as best they can. It's a shame that in Canada and in British Columbia in 2016, we have a thing called a tent city without people having a place to call home. So that's the challenge. So what are we doing? I was up island today with some other mayors on other topics, but I had the pleasure of having dinner with these two folks. And what I've heard very clearly is that coordination and centralization is key. It doesn't mean that any service provider goes out of business. It doesn't mean that anyone stops fighting or keeps fighting for funding. It doesn't mean that. What it means is that we need to come together as a region. Now, the good news is we're doing that. The CRD board took an unprecedented vote in December to come together to create the Regional Housing First Initiative and put in $30 million. The provincial government 2 weeks ago matched that, so we have another $30 million. And word on the street, or in the murmurings of cabinet in Ottawa anyways, is that the federal government is going to come together and put in another $30 million. So we'll have $90 million to build new, supportive, and affordable housing in this region, and that is a very good thing. But the key, as I've learned from these mayors, is coordination. And thankfully, the Coalition to End Homelessness, the CRD, BC Housing, and Island Health are all working together in an unprecedented and coordinated way to make sure that when this money comes into our community, it's going to go out to meet the greatest need. So the Coalition to End Homelessness has been around since 2008, and it is the regional coordinating body. And that body recently went through a governance review and has sharpened its focus on action. So instead of, in addition to continuing to welcome proposals from service providers for other levels of government funding, our Regional Housing First initiative will look around the region on the ground right now and see what are the biggest challenges. And then every year, starting this October, a call for proposals will go out to actually meet the needs, not based on who has what piece of land or who donated what building, that's certainly part of it, but what are the needs. And Island Health, BC Housing, and the Coalition to End Homelessness will work together to determine those needs on a regional basis, and that's the housing that will be built. Now, it doesn't sound very radical, but that's not what's happened. Housing providers have been doing a fantastic job building new housing, and they will continue to do that. And our Regional Housing First initiative will be a coordinated, centralized approach to making sure that we're building the housing for the people who need it most. So the focus for the next 5 years is ending chronic homelessness in the region. And with $90 million and amazing housing providers in this region, we might just be able to do that. So what's our challenge in the region in addition to Tent City? Many of you may not know this, but the Coalition to End Homelessness recently conducted a point-in-time count, and in our region at that point in time, and it was a night in February, there are 1,300 people in this region who are homeless. And over 200 of those people are under the ages of 18. So a coordinated effort needs to include a coordinated effort to house families and children. The other thing I think that's really important is that, and this is challenging, I know, We're used to the way we do things in Victoria, and we like the way we do things in Victoria. And I think we have a wealth of experience, not just in these two mayors, but in other efforts around the country and around North America, where we have some things to learn. And I think that's okay. And I think that we're going to need to do things a little bit differently. And I don't know exactly what that looks like, but I think we need to be willing to try things like Kitty's Opportunity Village. I think we need to be willing, I mean, the rest stops, I don't even know what the community wants to think about that. A purpose-built tent city, we tried that and it didn't go over well. So I'm curious to learn more. I'm curious to learn more about how that actually is working in Eugene. So we're doing some great things here in Victoria, and we can continue to do those things. And I think it's great to have new ideas from outside that can help us change our practice and not throw away what we're doing, but can build on what we're doing and make it better so that every person in the city, and particularly every person in the region, has a place to live. So Don Evans told me that the capacity of this building is 800 people, and it looks full. And that's a lot of community power. That is a lot of people here who are going to learn some things tonight from our guests from Medicine Hat and Eugene. And so that's my invitation to all of us. Let's learn together tonight. Let's learn everything we can. And then if each of us, every single one of the 800 people here, takes away one small nugget of learning and then turns that into an action. Maybe it's a small action, maybe it's a big action, but one small learning turned into one small action times 800, in addition to the coordinated effort at the CRD, BC Housing and Island Health with the coalition. That is a lot of effort. So that is my challenge to all of us. Let's listen. Let's learn, let's act, and then let's invite Mayor Clugston back here, whenever it might be, when we've ended homelessness, and we can tell him what we've learned. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. We're going to get into some questions here in just a moment. Something else I just want to make clear to you as a part of the spirit of this evening and the way that this came together. The City of Medicine Hat and the City of Eugene, Oregon paid for their mayors to fly here. They paid for that, for them to come here. I think that's a very important thing to make clear. So I'm curious about something here that's a form of a question that was put before me to pose of you. But I'll start with you, Ted. What have you learned since you've been here?
Well, can you hear me?
Yep.
I had a little bit of a reaffirmation here today. I've never been through a tent city, to tell you the truth. I don't think if I've even Googled one. I've been telling the other mayors that, I get bogged down in all the things that I'm dealing with running with the municipality, and I think you both know what that's like. And Medicine Hat is even in a more unique position in that we own an oil company and a gas company and electric generation and distribution companies and a land and property company. And so I've got these business units, and sometimes you get so caught up in the day-to-day operations that I forget the success that we've had in Medicine Hat and how powerful it is. And I was just reminded today about that when I said beacon of hope, and it maybe sounds a little cheesy or corny or cliche, but I was reminded again today. Thank you.
Mayor Piercy, the same thing. What have you learned so far since you've been here?
Well, I think one of the most important things is how similar we are, how much we share about not only the issue at hand, but who we are as communities and what we care about and what we want to solve. And then I think I feel a very strong feeling from my community and from his community and you all that we can do this. I feel like we can do this. We can, over time, with a concerted effort, provide more affordable housing, prevent more people from getting into homelessness, and try to come up with some innovative solutions to tide us between one place and another. I think we have the deep concern for people. I think we have the talent, and I think we have the desire to do it. And we are stronger together to go after this. So I'm for Canada and the United States teaming up and working on this together.
Hear, hear.
And I think, considering the venue in which we're sitting right now, I'm okay to ask this of Mayor Lisa Help so far in all of this. Has there been a come-to-Jesus moment for you? Has something happened in this discussion with either of them or what you've learned from them?
Come to Jesus. The region has really come together around this issue, starting at the CRT, well, starting with what Councillor Susan Bryce called the audacious proposal from the City of Victoria to borrow $30 million and ask for matching funding. So it started at that, but really it was the regional table that said, you know what, yes, we're going to do this. So I think what I'm hearing from these folks is that we're going in the right direction by centralizing and coordinating our approach as a region. So that's affirming, and I think that Victoria and Eugene maybe will become sister cities in ending homelessness, and then we'll celebrate when we've done that.
There we go. Thank you. One of the things that's also apparent here, of course, and it's stating the obvious, but Eugene, Oregon's in the United States, and Medicine Hat and Victoria are in Canada. The structure is a little bit different in intergovernmental relations when it comes to healthcare, which includes mental health and physical health and all the rest of it. Mayor, what have you noticed in the difference in Canada in the way that we do it compared to the system within which you work?
Well, of course, you've been providing services that we haven't been providing for a long time, and we look to you for that. But what I heard today was that even though you have mental health services, you don't have enough of them. What I heard today is you have health care services, but it's not even, and it doesn't meet all the needs. So I think to that degree, we've got, as you know, we've got Obamacare, and we're working away on that. And so we have some improvements in our system, but we have vast holes in our system, and I think that's what we're talking about, that the system as it is in the United States and as it is in Canada isn't uniformly fair to everyone. And that's the issue that we can do better. Yeah.
Mayor Cluston, you made reference to the fact that Canada needs to look at establishing a national housing strategy, which is something that's been around for quite some time. Both of you, Lisa and Mayor, you work with other levels of government. Do you get pushback? Do you get cooperation? I'll ask you first. Do you get some indication that this is actually going to happen?
No, frankly, that's a little bit out of my realm. We've worked very, very well with the provincial government, and basically the provincial government has allowed us to have the success that we've had. Federally, it's been minuscule as far as I know. But what am I hearing? Is anything coming? You know, that's a bit out of my expertise.
Lisa, anything intergovernmental you want to talk about?
Sure. Well, I think everyone expects the city to solve all the problems, whether it's a pothole or a housing crisis. And we don't have the resources to do that. And the way to get those resources is to build relationships. And the City of Victoria has a very positive relationship with the province of British Columbia right now, and I'm very grateful for that. I think that collaborative relationship is what unleashed $30 million from the province. And it was after the CRD passed its motion to get $30 million, I just kept talking about how the province is going to soon announce their funding. Now that we've got that $30 million, now I'm just going to start talking about how the federal government is going to soon announce their funding. So it is a partnership. We're the weakest partner in some ways, so the strongest thing we can do is be open and collaborate.
Yeah. Mayor Pearson. Yeah.
I guess I can only speak from my end. I think I had the experience of being a legislator before I had the experience of being mayor, which makes me bold because I kind of know what's on the other end. And so as an example, we were talking about this at dinner. I decided that our homeless situation really required us to declare an emergency. Portland had declared an emergency, and the reason they had declared an emergency is that it would clear codes and things that were in the way of them getting quick access to facilities and things of that sort. So they had a real reason for doing it. In Eugene, we have no facilities to clear for, so it doesn't apply uniformly. But I thought, well, I will ask the governor to declare an emergency. So I did a resolution with my council to get the governor to declare an emergency. She called me almost in the middle of the night and said, please don't do that. And because declaring emergency means that you have used all your city resources, the county has used all of their resources, and then it's like you have a flood or something, right? And so then you go to the federal government. So I said, okay, I'll call it a crisis as opposed to an emergency. But and so we sent the resolution up to the state, to the legislature, and to the governor. And a number of cities did it at the same time, and that made them pay attention. And so we had a very, we had a pretty robust allocation out of the last legislative session, and I think it was made far more robust because we were bold enough to join together and say we've got a serious crisis on our hands and you guys have some responsibility to step up and help us do this. And I think we have to keep doing that with our federal level and our state level, and just and then joining with those other mayors up and down the West Coast so I can work with mayors all over the nation to say that kind of thing. I think you just got to be, pull out all the stops because the need is great enough that pulling out all the stops makes really good sense.
Thank you. I don't think it's unfair to say that there are a lot of people in all of your communities and all of your municipalities across this country and across your country who are afraid of homelessness, who are afraid of the people who are wrapped up in homelessness. At the same time, it probably comes through a misunderstanding or a stigma that's still attached to mental health, that's still attached to challenges of mental health, the addiction issues that go along with that. So I want to ask you about a couple of things. First of all, how do you deal with the public backlash? Too many people feel the solution lies within the police, which it doesn't. So the mental health and addiction management within your community and managing the backlash when you do undertake programs to help the people that we're here to talk about tonight. Lisa, why don't you take a stab at that one?
I wanted to go last on that one.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. It's very challenging. I think I'll just tell a story to answer that question. Yeah. And this event is mostly organized by Our Place and co-hosted by Our Place and the city and First Met. And this is a story. This is what you do when there's backlash. So BC Housing came to us right before Christmas and asked, is there any vacant city facility that we could use to put some people in from the tent city if they're willing to go and if it would be a good fit for them? And we had, in response to the proposal at Topaz Park, that didn't go over well, but what we did do out of Topaz Park was we hosted a workshop. We were actually discussing this at our table at dinner tonight. We had over 400 people come to the conference center, the Crystal Gardens, and give us ideas about how we could shelter people temporarily. And the number one idea that came up that night and from the online survey was to repurpose vacant city buildings. And so when BC Housing came and said, could we borrow the old Boys and Girls Club for some time to have a temporary transitional housing, and it's not a shelter. A shelter is where you have to leave every day. I guess my place is kind of like an indoor rest stop, actually. Hmm. And it was right before Christmas, and the minister went on CFAX and announced that he was doing this. We'd been working quietly with the school board to try and the principal to try and say, this might be coming, how would you feel? But there was the minister making his announcement, and so we were left scrambling. And so what we did is we held a community meeting on December the 30th, right in the middle of the holidays. If we'd waited till after, my place would have been open, and we would have been criticized for opening it without having a meeting. We held it in the middle of the holidays, so we were criticized for having it in the middle of the holidays. So it goes. But that's just the setup. Here's the real point. Here's how you deal with backlash. You sit at the front of the room. It was myself and Don Evans and Roger Butcher from BC Housing, and you listen. You listen to every single concern and fear and worry that people have, and you take it seriously. And then if you're Don Evans, and really the kudos goes out to him and his team, you design an operating model that's going to serve the people who are moving in there, because that's the point, that's what we're doing. So you do that. But your operating model also takes into account the concerns of the surrounding neighborhood. So when they show up at the community meeting angry and afraid, you don't say your anger is unwarranted, your fear is unwarranted, you are a NIMBY. You don't say that. You say, let's listen, and then let's build a model around your fears and your worries. and that has obviously the care, compassion, and concern of the people we're trying to help. So we did that. Don and his team did that. And what happened when BC Housing asked us for an extension months later, the same people came to the community meeting and they said, boy, nothing that I was afraid of actually happened. And it's because Don and his team listened. So that's how you deal with backlash. You listen and then you act.
These questions were provided to us beforehand, and I should have prepared better. So in Medicine Hat, it's completely different. I told the story about mental health and the stigma and the schizophrenia walk, and we are working very hard on that, and people's attitude are changing. I am seeing it in my own community regarding mental health and much more tolerance and acceptance and recognizing that it's an illness. What backlash did we deal with? Frankly, none, is to tell you the truth. We didn't really consult, as I've been telling. We built affordable housing units in neighborhoods and just kind of did it. And we've been talking about neighborhood contracts. I think we only had neighborhood information. Oh, by the way, we've got this going up in your neighborhood and it's there. Now, for me, I received backlash because of the people who supported me for mayor and got help get me elected were like, when did you change? When did you become compassionate? When did you become a socialist? And so the only backlash I received was on a political level from my grassroots supporters.
So I would agree with everything that's been said here except the last. But I cannot remember us doing an affordable housing project where some people weren't fearful of the negative impact, and then they look at it and it's better looking than some of the houses around it. And they're always very successful. They do a really excellent job, but people always have their concerns. And I think it's really, I want to reemphasize that I think it's really important to acknowledge and honor people's worries. I also think that it's really important to for them to feel very heard, and that there are things, even in the people you disagree with the most, there's something to be learned, and you need to approach that in that way, that everybody's got something to bring to the table that's important to be heard. I will say this, and it works for me. When I've been talking about the homeless situation, we've got people in our community who really dislike homeless people. And we've got people in our community who would give the shirts off their backs and everything else to help homeless people. We've got both of those kind of people. I pretty much say to people, you know, and when you really get down to it, it's not a matter of whether you like them or not. You're going to be happier and they're going to be happier if they're housed. It's a practical thing. If you don't like seeing people on the street corner, then do something so they don't have to be on the street corner. If you don't want to spend those extra thousands and thousands of dollars on public safety or emergency services or other kinds of impacts, then do something so you don't have to do that. So I think it doesn't have to be us versus them. I think it's that we will all benefit when we house people who don't have housing.
We've spoken about the involvement or lack of involvement by different levels of government and the cooperation there, and we've looked at a profile of what each of your communities do. This event tonight is being presented by Our Place, which is a nonprofit organization. I have an affiliation with the United Way, which is a nonprofit organization. Government and nonprofit step up, but something else, which is indicated by where we're gathered here, is the role of faith-based organizations in the management and the dealing of this property, of this problem, rather. So, Mayor Clustin, can you talk about that in Medicine Hat, first of all, and what role, frankly, the church community plays in dealing with the issue there?
So I did mention the church community earlier, and you know, the faith-based, it's a calling, and they want to help, and they desire to help, and feel that they're required to help, and help your brother. And so in Medicine Hat, it's no different than any other church or any other faith-based community, they want to help. And so, and they do. And I turn around the churches and I see soup kitchens in churches, basements, and it's fantastic. But what I was trying to get at earlier is that system, that one-stop shop, that coordinated approach. And Medicine Hat, we've even gone as far now with not even just housing first, but now our food bank is moving into food first, and basically saying, you, in the old days, you had to come to the food bank and show your bank statement, prove that you weren't smoking or buying alcohol with, and you know, and show, and you'd be denied food if your bank statement showed that you had wasted money. And now it's just basically, we've almost taken that approach, same as the housing first. You come in, you need food, here's some food. And so we're trying to work with the church groups as well to use their resources to bring their food or their money that they're collecting into that one central location as well. So,
yeah. Thank you. Lisa, same thing here. This church is an example of that.
Sure. We have a very, very generous and committed and compassionate faith-based community in Victoria, and they do, or you do, a lot of good work. I think one of the things, one of the untapped assets, and I know that some churches are already working on this, churches have not a lot, but some land and some buildings. And if there's a way to partner between churches and housing developers or nonprofit developers to repurpose some of that land that may, could, I'm not saying this beautiful building, obviously, but there are some church lands that could, even in the estimation of churches, be put to better and higher use, maybe rebuilding that church hall or, you know, whatever purpose the church has, and then creating extra density for housing. So I think churches have, some of them are land rich, and I think that that's an opportunity to meet the needs of the church in terms of developing those assets and also meet the needs of the community. So that's the only thing I would say in addition to the great work the churches are already doing.
Thank you.
Really interesting to me that given that we're a community that deeply, deeply values the separation of church and state, we rely on our churches a lot. So I would say that in terms of the mission, the one shelter we have, that is a faith-based shelter. It's a good one. We need more. We need a public one too, but it's a good one. I would say that the Square One, Reverend Dan Bryant, who's been doing the micro housing opportunity village, comes at it from a religious background and has taken leadership on that whole issue for our micro housing project in Eugene. And Faye and Eric DeBurr, who do our rest stops, are just this. This is the way that this worked. They came to a council meeting and they said, you need to do something for these homeless people. We have this hut that we built, and we think it would be a perfect solution for people to live in while they're waiting to get into housing. And so I looked out at them and I said, that's a good idea. Why don't you do it? And so they did. So they have built five rest stops with 15 Conestoga huts on platforms for people to stay in on five different sites. So, and they've done it because they think it's the thing that they're supposed to do. We have Catholic services in St. Vincent de Paul. We have a camping program. We've had this camping program for a long time. That is that if you have space and you're willing to have people live on your site, you can have legally up to three, it can be a car, it can be a tent, or it can be a hut.
Do you mean in your backyard?
In this case, what I was talking about was church parking lots. So like one of our churches had three Conestoga huts put up on their church parking lot. And over time, they gained such confidence in the good behavior of the folks who were living in the huts that they opened up their kitchen and their restrooms for them to use. And now they're converting from the huts to building real micro houses for them on church property, 3 units. So that's that transition from making a legal place to making a permanent place to really being part of the solution. And the other thing that occurred to me when you asked this question, which I think is a really interesting question, is, and I haven't solved it yet, it's how do you catalyze all kinds of different congregations to do something? Not just some of them, but because some are more inclined than others. And so how do you talk the talk that we talked earlier about this will be something you'll want to do too, because it will be to your benefit and you'll want to be part of it, and to work with some of the more unlikely religious communities to see what contribution they can make to helping solve this issue.
Can you just clarify for us what a Conestoga hut is?
Yeah. So what Eric and Faith did is they took a wire and they made it. You know what a Conestoga wagon looks like?
Covered wagon.
Covered wagon.
Yeah.
It's like a covered wagon. It's just like this, right? Except this doesn't have wheels. So they do sort of a wire cage, and then they build wood over it, and it's like one room. It has a little window in it. It has a door. It has a lock, and people can be safe and keep their belongings safe. And the cost, I think the cost, they can produce one of those for about $1,200. So it's a fairly inexpensive solution. And so it's called Community Supported Shelters. You can Google it up. And they produced many of those. They've been very successful, safe shelter options for folks.
How much snow would they hold in Medicine Hat?
So I'm going to keep saying this about Medicine Hat. We didn't have winter this year. I never shoveled my driveway. So none.
Okay. That's 1,200 American, too, by the way. Question directly for the mayor of Medicine Hat from the floor. Now, as we go into this, we're going to probably repeat some stuff that we've covered before or bring clarity to some points that the mayor's brought up previously, too, but I'll ask these anyway. Mayor Clugston, can you give more detail about the concrete actions that Medicine Hat has taken to end homelessness?
Yeah, sure. So it was a 10-year plan from the province, the Housing First program, and Medicine Hat said, you know, 10 years is too long. We're going to do it in 5 years. And so I'm listening to these solutions, and I'm sorry, I'm not trying to say anything about covered wagons and tents and stuff. These, I'm sorry, are Band-Aids. They're not solutions. I don't mean anything bad, but so I'm just trying to put Medicine Hat in perspective that I don't want to sound like I'm bragging out here, but we're light years ahead. I mean, we give people permanent residences. And so we got lucky. We had and I think it's maybe some irony, is that we had the furthest right-wing conservative provincial government probably in the country that recognized the power of Housing First before any NDP government or Liberal government, provincial government did, I would say, and invested heavily in housing stock. And then we also worked with our private landlords as well with, you know, rental supplements and income supplements, sorry. And you've got to work with your private landlords and build their trust as well. And so we have some advantages that we didn't have. Well, we did. Alberta booms and busts. Sometimes we have 0% vacancy. Right now we have vacancy. Obviously, everybody knows the price of oil is, well, it's $50. But I don't even know where I was going with this. But yeah, I had an idea. But they believed in the process. They believed in Housing First. And we did it.
Next question directly to Mayor Piercy. Are mental health services on site and available at Opportunity and Emerald Villages?
So the one of the sites is actually built next to the Behavioral Health Center. So they just have to walk across the parking lot to get their mental health services, which is very convenient. Others, they have to make other arrangements, but yes. But I will say we are, like in many places, don't have adequate mental health, behavioral health treatment. So we need to do that. I did want to speak to the former thing.
Sure.
the former thing. Sorry. And what I wanted to say is I totally agree with my colleague here that it is totally right that everybody should be in real housing. And these other solutions or other things that we're doing in a Band-Aid way are only happening because we can't quite get there yet, and people have to have a place to be in the meantime. So we would never want people to think that being in a, even if it's safe, even if it's rainproof, it being in a hut of some kind without plumbing and electricity is adequate. It's not adequate, but it's better than being on the riverbank. And it's better than actually being in the tent camp that we saw earlier today. It's very organized. It's very clean. People have rules. They can lead a decent life and they can get their act together. So it's true. It's not the end game at all, but it's the best game we got, and it's better than no game at all.
I'll open this up to any or all of the mayors. How do you design housing that protects high-functioning individuals from those who are still addicted or dealing with severe mental illness? Transitional housing is an issue quite often, right? So putting someone...
I'll just say that for many years, we had very high-bar housing where people couldn't have access to shelter or transitional or permanent housing if they hadn't already pretty much licked their addiction. And one of the things that Housing First model talks about is that you have much greater chance of people getting their lives together if they have a roof over their heads. They need to have some kind of stability in their lives so they can make some better choices. And until they have that stability in their lives, they can't do that. So, or many can't. So that's, we've totally turned from that path to the more new Housing First model, which is a low bar model, which basically tries to get people in the door and get them housed and get them social services and help them move on with their lives. And that all over this, in our case, it's the state of Utah has done that and pretty much wiped out homelessness. And they've done it in Houston, Texas, and they've done it in New Orleans. And many places have tried this model, and it's really worked. So I think we know what we need to do. We just got to get it done.
Thank you.
Yeah, in terms of the question about how do we make sure that people who have high needs or certain needs aren't living with people who have other needs, and really I think that that's where Housing First comes in. Housing First is based on, yes, you give people housing first, but one element of the Housing First principle is choice. So it doesn't mean that you get to choose wherever you live and however you live. That's unrealistic. But it means that if there's a building that's being built, we need to make sure that either all of the people in that building have the same set of needs, or that there are service providers on hand or operators in the building to cater to the different needs. There might be two different kinds of populations or people with different sets of needs. Those people need different care and different support. So tailoring the operating model to the needs is really important so that everyone in the building feels safe. Because I'm recently on the board of the Capital Regional Housing Corporation, which is another amazing entity in our community. I was looking, Mayor Screech is the chair of that organization. And Capital Regional Housing Corporation has, I think, over 1,500 properties, and that's certainly a concern for some of the tenants. Someone moves in with really high needs and it's disruptive to the building, that person who's moving in needs the support. And so the Capital Regional Housing Corporation, just recently at our last meeting, is doing a pilot project with Island Health, so that Island Health will come in and provide one-on-one supports to people living in CRHC housing, so to make sure that everyone's safe and secure.
Well, you have the microphone in your hand.
Oh, yes.
Two-part question here. Will the many millions of dollars promised be spent throughout the region or just in Victoria? And can all 13 municipalities work together to address homelessness?
I'll answer the last one first. It's kind of funny. There's laughing and clapping and, you know, gesticulating about, can we do it? Well, you know what? We already are. That's the thing. That motion on December the 9th was a historic vote of the CRD board saying we're all going to come together and do this. So not only can we, but we already are. CRD staff have a mandate. The Coalition to End Homelessness is coming up with a plan for this year's call for proposal. So absolutely. Will the housing be built in all 13 municipalities? I hope so. And one reason is that land is really expensive in Victoria. And the further out you go, the cheaper land gets. And so one of the things that I think we're going to need to do as a regional community is to do a land inventory. What are all of the municipally or local government owned land in the region? And then maybe some of that comes forward as part of the housing proposal. So people have different needs. Not everyone wants to live in downtown Victoria. This is a regional solution, and we're going to take a regional approach. And not only can we, the laughing and clapping, we already are. And I think just watch us.
We have touched on this already, but maybe we can just go into a bit more detail. We'll start in Medicine Hat with this one. What are the initiatives planned to address specifically youth homelessness?
We actually do have a plan. We have dealing with, there's some certain housing, especially with those in foster care. There's some transitional. We recognize that, you know, if they've been in foster care, they moved around a lot. They have a very high risk of becoming homelessness or become homeless. And so we do have some plans to do with that, as well as those perhaps recently released from incarceration. And we do recognize that and a third of the people, or the third of the people we've housed, have been basically under the age of 18.
Mayor Piercy, youth.
So I'll just piggyback that I actually think working with kids coming out of the foster care system is one segment of the population we should actually be able to make sure get totally housed. You know who they are already. The state has been responsible for them as they've been growing up. It's not fair to set them loose at some point with no place to be. So to me, it just seems like if we just all said we're going to make sure that happens, I think it's totally doable, and we ought to do it. Last year is we rehabbed an old apartment building, made it really new, and it's all for kids coming out of foster care, and it's the first one in the state of Oregon. So we're proud of that. We have engaged our business community, actually, in this 15th night effort where they really want to work on mentoring and focusing in on kids who are either at risk of being homeless or recently homeless, to see if they can give them the resources they need to be housed in one way or another. So that's a project that's underway right now. And I appreciated the comment about people coming out of the prison system. I just want you to know that the mayor of Los Angeles told me that they thought a huge portion of their homeless population were people who were dumped out. We had prison reform, and which sounds good and is, but it's one thing to reform and the other is to open the door and toss people out and say good luck. So that's what's happened, and so we have an organization called Sponsors, which you can look up if you'd like, in Eugene, that really works hard with people coming out of the prison system to get them ready to adjust and make their way back into the life, and offers them, they've got two levels now, the housing program for when they first come out, and then after they succeeded in the program, then they get into another level of housing. So we have all of those things that we're working on.
Thank you. Lisa?
Thanks. Just some data first, and Don Elliott, the executive director of the coalition, is here somewhere, and I apologize if I get the data wrong, but as I said earlier, when we did our point in time count, we had over 1,300 people in the region who are homeless. Of those 1,300 people, 721 agreed to fill out a more detailed survey. And of the 721 people who filled out a detailed survey, 39% of them experienced homelessness for the first time when they were under 18. So, and then just stay in that situation or move in and out of that situation. So my suspicion, and again, this is just a guess, and we're not making guesses with this $90 million. We're going to do it on a data-driven way. But my guess is that one of the first calls that we'll see go out for the Regional Housing First Initiative money will be for youth homelessness. So I don't want to presuppose what the coalition, the CRD, BC Housing, and Island Health will come up with in terms of what the call for proposals is this October. But youth homelessness is certainly, I think, anecdotally a priority, but we'll wait and see what the data bears out, but I think we'll see some of that money go to youth homelessness soon, this year or next, but hopefully this year.
Thank you. A word that hasn't come up yet tonight is the word poverty. Poverty, of course, is integral. I don't want to oversimplify this, but poverty is a huge cause and a factor in homelessness. And there are a remarkably high percentage of people who are living with physical or developmental or cognitive disabilities who find themselves living in poverty for whatever reason. So a question for all the mayors: what has been done to create appropriate supportive housing for persons living with disabilities? Sure, let's go to Eugene first.
So one of the things we've done with our affordable housing projects, a number of them have a certain number of rooms targeted for people with disabilities or special needs. So that is, we've definitely taken a long-term affirmative approach to trying to be inclusionary in our affordable housing.
I'm looking to for some help here up here. I have to answer this one, and she's whispering the answer to me. PSH. Purpose-built housing. There you go.
Again, when we approve or when service providers build affordable housing, usually a certain number of units are accessible. But I think my honest and simple answer is not enough. We're not doing enough.
An issue that has come up peripherally when you were talking about some of the plans and the programs that you have in place, and I'll again address this to everyone or anyone. What happens when a person is asked to leave a transitional or temporary housing circumstance because of whatever reason, through disruption or failure to abide by the rules? What happens to them, if you're able to answer that? Is there counseling imposed and put in place or made available? Do you have any examples of what happens to those people?
I'll take a stab at it.
Okay.
And say that I think a vast majority of people who are managing some kind of mental health issue or disability issue or behavioral issue have some kind of person who's from social services who's working with them and sort of following them along. And so if they fail, and I've experienced this with somebody I know very well, they're told, here's why you failed, ready to try again. And then they try to work with them about what kind of housing might be appropriate. What are they going to do in the meantime? How are they going to get by until they can get back in another program?
Mm-hmm.
And most programs that deal with this population, and this is certainly not perfect in any way, but most of those programs recognize, as you do, I am sure, that people who are trying to get have addiction issues and trying to get well, you can expect a huge amount of them to fall off the wagon, and they'll need to get back on again. So you have to have reentry opportunities, and you have to have multiple reentry opportunities. That's just part of what needs to be built in.
Well, what happens here is, in most cases, not all, and again, the threshold is different at every building and every housing provider, but they get evicted, and then they go to our place. And so the cycle begins. And so I think something that's missing in our housing ecosystem is a place where people won't get evicted. And that's very hard, that's very challenging, but evicting people is sometimes not the answer, no matter what the mental health episode or the addiction episode. And I think we have some things to learn from our colleagues at the Portland Hotel Society. One of the things I didn't mention earlier, the Coalition to End Homelessness has formed what we're calling a Priority One Task Force. It's made up of myself as the co-chair of the coalition, the police, Island Health, First Nations representative, BC Housing, the judge from the integrated court. So we're really trying to figure out, there are about 75 or 100 people who just get evicted over and over, because it's not that they're hard to house, it's that we don't have housing that meets their needs. And so we're taking a trip over to Vancouver to tour some of the Portland Hotel Society facilities at the end of June to see what lessons we can learn and bring back to have those kinds of facilities, and not necessarily run by Portland Hotel Society. Our place is already doing that kind of thing, but they don't have a facility to do that. So the simple answer now is those people get evicted and they go to our place, and then we see them hanging out, and then people get mad, and it's not the answer. So we need to meet people's actual needs and not evict them, in my opinion.
Again, this is open to any and all. What can municipalities do to reduce zoning barriers to building small, portable housing? We have 13 municipalities here where we deal with that sort of thing, but you in your own jurisdiction, what can you do to take barriers down in creating those opportunities?
So if you're talking about zoning barriers, like allowing those type of what I've been calling band-aid solutions, having people living in tents and churches or the what we wouldn't, frankly, to tell you in Medicine Hat, we wouldn't change those rules. The reason why we have the Housing First and the reason why we have ended homelessness is because we have permanent housing, so we don't want to change the rules or change the zoning laws so that you can allow the band-aid solutions.
Mayor?
Well, we've over the years done a number of things to accommodate some kinds of temporary solutions, because we think you have to live in that world while you're aiming for the other world. And the other thing that I think is happening right now that's really important is our housing markets are getting squeezed so tight, and the people who've been living in low-income housing are seeing their rents go up 50% or more, and they can't stay in their housing anymore. So we are really going to have some work sessions coming up where we're really going to try to work on how do we protect housing for various income folks and keep them viable in our community. In Portland, for example, which is, and San Francisco has this issue as well, it's such a popular place to live that the landlords can get anything they need for those units, and so it's pushing everybody who's lower income out of the cities. And so we have to find ways to reel that thing back in and try to make sure our cities are good places for everybody to live. And we're going to be working very hard on doing that. And I wanted to say there is something kind of unique. During the recession, the only kind of housing that financial institutions would pay for were student housing, because we have like 25,000 university students in our community. And so they wouldn't do condos, they wouldn't do single unit dwellings, they wouldn't do apartments, they wouldn't do anything but student housing. So we had this huge overbuild, because anybody who had any property or anything, that's what they did. So they did a big overbuild of student housing. So I'm sort of trying to look at how you take some of the older student housing and repurpose it and turn it back into more affordable housing. So you're kind of taking what's coming out one side and bringing it back around the other to try to keep some of that housing diversity that we need in our community.
In terms of zoning regulations for temporary structures, there's a thing called a temporary use permit, and it's not a rezoning per se. Well, it's not a rezoning. The threshold of public consultation and public engagement is a lot less. It's a legislative tool that councils can use. It's good for 3 years and can be renewed for another 3 years, so a maximum of 6 years. So the challenge isn't the tools. We have the tools. The challenge is working with the community to implement. And a very courageous group of people, some of whom are here tonight, have formed. Actually, we had some folks from Opportunity Village and Dignity Village come and make a presentation to the community last May. And out of that, a group called the Victoria Microhousing Society formed. And this group is an amazing group. There's high school students, there's people who are unhoused, there's people who are housed, there are architects, there's just about everybody under the sun that's come together to build or want to build microhousing. And they came to City Council just to say, will you accept our proposal on a piece of land for six people? And I was telling Kitty this earlier, we have a Made in Victoria solution for microhousing, or they do. It's six microhousing units, but it reads like a single family bungalow on the street. So there are six units, a shared kitchen, laundry facilities, a shared living area, and then everyone has their own microhousing unit. And it's a little bit of a complicated situation because at some point in the history of the city, some engineer agreed that that could be residential parking. So there are people who park there, so that makes it a little bit more complicated. But there may be other pieces of city land where we can let these microhousing Victoria people do an experiment and build six small units that look like a bungalow. That's easy. We can do a temporary use permit. The challenge came, and again, we have to take it seriously and listen to the fears and worries. The challenge came from the nearby neighbors who imagined that Tent City would recreate itself on this lot. So we have the tools. We have temporary use permits. They're very easy. We can, you know, get the microhousing people to go meet with the neighborhood, which they've done. But it really needs to be building understanding with the community about what is a six-unit microhousing micro-living village. I don't even know if six units is a village. But anyways, what is this and how can it fit in onto any single family lot in the city? So we have the tools. It's going to take work with the community and then political courage to implement, I think.
So the Emerald Village concept that I showed you in my presentation is going to have like 20, I think, but they're all designed by architects, and we've worked really hard, like you talked about, with the neighborhood, and those are going to be more permanent. The Opportunity Village is different. Those are all temporary, and they only come under temporary rules that allow them to be there on, but they can't, they're not installed, so to speak.
Mayor, you raised an interesting point in your initial remarks, too, about finding a place to live, the supply and demand, the availability of suites. Someone here is curious, what's the average vacancy rate for your community?
It's actually been about 2%, which is hardly anything. So it's very low. And when we were working on housing our homeless vets, we had many vets who had vouchers, and they couldn't find a unit to use their vouchers for. So we have all of these. I think it's really important, and I'm sure you all know this, but I just think you can't ever look at a piece of this in isolation of the rest. You have to be building your economy so that people can take care of themselves at the same time that you're trying to provide affordable housing for people who need it at the same time that you're doing your temporary housing. You need all those pieces. But the idea is if we're actually successful at all of this, we will have fewer and fewer people homeless as opposed to more and more, and the need will decrease over time. We will see how we fare with it because what's happening with the federal level and the gap between the haves and the have-nots is kind of out of our hands, and so it lands in our local laps. But we don't know how long that chasm between the economic chasm that currently exists is going to keep on sending people off the edge, and that's just a condition we live with right now.
Vacancy rate?
Our vacancy rate is inversely proportional to the price of oil, so it's been as low as 1% when oil's at 100, and right now it's at 4.9% because oil's at $50, so we move, go up and down and up and down.
Yeah. Lisa, what are we doing here now?
Well, the latest number is 0.6%, but then when you're talking about a two-bedroom or particularly three-bedroom, it's 0.00001%. So there's almost no vacancies for families.
Another point that we've all come to understand over time, and it will be a matter of time before everybody catches on, for the taxpayer, it's cheaper to house someone than to keep them in a homeless circumstance. So can all of you talk just a little bit about the impact that the homelessness factor in your community has on your tax base? The cost of 911 services, of policing, of all that sort of thing. The fact that if you were to provide more housing, it would not cost municipalities as much to manage them. Does it impact you in a huge way, small way?
So this is what I talk about. This, now you're in my wheelhouse, finally.
There we go. Okay.
ultimately, there only is one taxpayer. And so this is when I was talking about earlier that I wasn't on board with the Housing First program. It was because of the financial sense that Housing First makes sense. And I was talking about the furthest right-wing government. Well, it was a fiscal conservative government in the province of Alberta that recognized that it saved the province money, and ultimately the tax, one taxpayer money. And, you know, we like to say that it's $20,000 a year in medicine at the house someone versus that $80,000 to $120,000 a year to treat them on the street as an acute or as an acute problem, which actually is a chronic problem. And so that is what originally allowed me to get on board with the Housing First program, is just the sheer numbers. Now, later on, I grew up and I also recognized the moral sense of it and the actual, you know, helping your brother, your fellow citizen. But the other thing is we've been able to track interactions with the first responders, with the healthcare, with the paramedics, with the police, with the judicial system, and we have been able to show that over time, all those interactions go down, and every one of those interactions costs a fortune. If it's an emergency room visit, there's $1,000. A stay in the hospital, there's $2,000, and you can buy a lot of housing with that healthcare money, frankly. Mm-hmm. And so it just makes sense. So if the government, any level of government, wants to actually, one of your best rates of return or financial payback is providing housing.
So what he just said, there's evidence all over the place. It's been tried over and over again, and the evidence is really clear, and we've done that kind of look. They actually did way back, I think maybe almost 6 to 8 years ago, they did a study on a homeless guy, Million Dollar Murray, I think was the story. Yeah.
Million Dollar Murray.
Right. And they just tracked him, and he cost $1 million. So that, to them, really showed that when they got him into that it was very expensive to have people unhoused on your streets. So.
Bruce, if I may, yep. One Canadian stat, and this comes from one of the national organizations working on homelessness. Their research shows that on an annual basis across Canada, it costs the one taxpayer that Mayor Clugston points to $7 billion per year for homelessness. $7 billion. That's what it's costing taxpayers annually in Canada. And the organization estimates that in order to house every single one of those people across Canada and keep them housed and provide them with the health care they need, it would cost $4.5 billion annually. So that's an actual savings of $2.5 billion a year just to house people. So those are the hard facts for the nation.
Thank you. The last question for tonight is actually for all of the people here that are elected officials that are holding office, whether it's municipally or provincially or whatever it is. And Lisa, on behalf of all of them, we're going to ask you this question for the answer. How can we help you take care of this problem? What can we as the general public do to help you?
Well, coming here tonight was a good start. I don't remember which of you said this earlier. I think it was Kitty, that if you're in a conversation with somebody and they strongly disagree with your point of view on this topic, get more curious and get more interested and try and close that understanding gap. I know that seems like such a small thing. I mean, there are a million more things that you can do. You can donate to Our Place. You can donate to any housing provider. You can volunteer. There's no shortage of things. You can write letters. You can write a letter to the Prime Minister when that $30 million from the federal government comes forward. There's no shortage of things you can actually get up and do every day. Google Homeless Help Victoria, and you'll find any manner of things to do. And in addition to that, I think the most important thing that each of us need to do is when there's an understanding gap, and there are understanding gaps right now in our community on this issue. There are people who are homeless who have been stigmatized and polarized, and there are people who want their neighborhoods to go back to what they bought into who are stigmatized and polarized. Yes, some are more privileged than others. I totally get that. But I think we've been having a very difficult conversation as a community. And so, and those are hard conversations. And believe me, I'm at the, you know, someone told me once that courage is jumping into the eye of the storm and keeping your heart open. So I have these hard conversations all the time, but if there's one thing that each of us can do is when we encounter someone who has a very different opinion on this subject, listen, be curious, and try and find what it is that's common between the two of you or the four of you or the ten of you, and then even more, try and find one small thing that you can do together, even though you started off from a place of difference.
So I think the biggest thing that any of us can do, and I've sort of said this earlier, but I just want to re-emphasize it. We live in a world now where people think the homeless issue is so large you cannot do it. You cannot resolve it. Well, you've heard that you can, and you've heard it's happened in a number of places, but we still have this sort of self-defeated conversation about this issue, and it takes people really talking about that you can do it. We know how to, and we can do it. That kind of conversation here locally and in communities all across Canada and across the United States can change our acceptance of this number of homeless unhoused folks in our communities everywhere, and we shouldn't accept anything less.
May I say something before we
sure.
Before we wrap up? I just want to, I said earlier that if we were having this discussion in my city, there wouldn't be anybody here. However, if your garbage was picked up 10 minutes late, I'd fill 10 of these churches, or if we were discussing a change in the pet bylaw. nothing gets my citizens out more than that. And so this was, I don't want to speak for you, but this was an easy exercise for Mayor Percy and myself. We don't live in this community. But I think you owe your mayor an applause here. She talked about courage. It is very, very difficult to come out and talk to your citizens on a very controversial issue, especially as you talked about courage in the eye of the storm. So, congratulations.
Our heartfelt thanks to Mayor Kitty Piercy of Eugene, Oregon, to Mayor Ted Clugston of Medicine Hat, Alberta, and Mayor Lisa Helps of Victoria. Amazing answers. Thank you all for being here.
And if you want to check out, there's other sites where you can see these pictures and information. I just Googled it myself, and I was able to find out more information about the fire and what happened to all of us residents. The landlord of the building didn't even show up to see any of the residents, to see help them. But anyway, we think he was behind the fire. I think it's an insurance scam, personally. And he also made us move our belongings out of the building before we can get our damage deposits back. And I think that was completely wrong, because we were victims of a crime. The fire set by somebody, it was arson. And we weren't even allowed back in to get our belongings and stuff. It went a long, drawn-out process to get back in and get our belongings, which were all pretty much ruined and smoke damaged anyway. So it was horrible. You know, I had been there for almost 8 months living there, and I made it home. And then it all came to an end. And ever since, it's been bump. And during the whole process, you know, it's been so hard because my wife and I, you know, have problems. We're both on disability. We have many barriers. that stopped us from doing things and getting things accomplished. And we are trying our absolute best. I would have to ask anybody in the Salvation Army about me and my wife and how hard we have been able to find a home. They've been putting good words for us, and we're extremely thankful for it. I just don't know what's going to happen now. Pretty much all I can say, what's going to happen. I hope something comes from this meeting and somebody sees me and recognizes me and can hear my story and help all of us. We're about to be thrown out on the street. God.
All right, well, I will then sit right there.
My name is Chaz Simon Duff. Okay. And I'll speak to anybody who wants to talk to me.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.